Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this Sunday as we begin our worship, we welcome you for this time of worship where we experience the living and resurrected Jesus.
Preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Corporate Confession. Generous and merciful God, we confess to you and to our sisters and brothers that we have sinned against you, against one another, against your creation, in thought, word and deed, through our ignorance, our weakness and our deliberate disobedience. We are truly sorry. Forgive us all that is past and grant us the gift of new life. In Christ Jesus our Savior. Amen.
May the gracious and merciful God grant to you pardon and remission of all your sins, time for newness of life, and the grace and comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Gloria. Glory to God in highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. recollect. Faithful God, the strength of all who believe and the hope of those who doubt. May we who have not seen have faith and receive the fullness of Christ's blessings, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The reading is taken from 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 3 to 9. Praise to God for a living hope. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fail. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him, and even though you do not see Him now, you believe in Him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Jesus, 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 Jes Listen to the good news. Proclaim the gospel according to St. John, chapter 20, from verses 19 onwards. Jesus appears to his disciples. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Jesus appears to Thomas. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands, reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning. Hope you are doing good and staying safe, of course. Well, I'd like to look at the gospel which was read to us, the passage from Gospel of John. Let's break this passage into a few different sections. In the beginning of this passage, it talks about, now Jesus is no more with the disciples after the crucifixion. Disciples were alone. They were hiding in fear, they were scared, and they were hiding inside a room. In the next section, Jesus comes to them with peace. He comes and shows his wounds, and wounds on his hands and on the side. Seeing these wounds, definitely these disciples get really overjoyed, knowing that Jesus is living. But Thomas was not in the crowd. But when these disciples told Thomas that they saw the Lord in person physically, he never wanted to believe. He says, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Mind you, my friends, Thomas and his disciples, especially Thomas, was a disciple who was with the Lord for 3.5 years in his ministry. He has seen many miracles that the Lord does, and the love of Christ and the compassion that he had towards people. He have heard the Lord speaks about his death and the resurrection. He have ate with Lord, walked with Lord, gone to every place with God, and for 24/7 he was with the Lord. Yet when the disciples, rest of the disciples, says that he is living, still he doubts. Aren't we the same? If someone comes and asks us the promises of God and how what we believe in God, we will tell the whole load of it. We know the incredible miracles that he has done and the stories that we know from the Bible. We know what he has done in our lives. We know what he has done around us. Yet when the real trouble comes, when we really get pushed against the wall, don't we panic? Don't we get scared? Don't we doubt him? Well, we are very uncomfortable of this uncertainty that it creates, right? We are we feel that we lose control and we try everything to gain this control back, and we get so stressed out in this whole passage. We are so reluctant to go through this passage of suffering and pain, where that not knowing when it will end, so that we really struggle in this process. This is where the first epistle of Peter comes in very handy. Mind you, Peter is actually writing to an audience who is already having an opposition, and this audience is already persecuted, and he writes to them. In the beginning of the epistle, he talks about the promise and the inheritance God have in store for us in heaven. He says that God says that the inheritance is in heaven. Come, have it. I want you to have it out of pure love. It says, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. My dear friends, our real destination is actually in heaven. God never says, your inheritance is in the world. No, he says, come, your inheritance is in heaven. Yet, while we stay in this world, God expects something from us, and that is genuine faith. He wants us to be having genuine faith in him and in Christ and his good works. Of course, knowing that at every point of our life that God is present. Also, he says, for the person who has this genuine faith, that he will protect him, guard him, and shield him from all enemy and evil spirits. Well, isn't it clear that God has been testing people and testing the genuine faith of people from the beginning? If we really look at the Old Testament, let's look at the life of Abraham. Abraham was promised of a generation from him, but he never had a son at the early stage of his life. But towards the latter part of his life, or in old age, he is blessed with a son. After some time, God asks him to go and sacrifice him. Same with the Israelites. Israelites were saved from Egypt, from slavery, and told that I'm going to give you a promised land. But God never took them there in like a few hours or a few days. It took them 40 years. Quite a passage in wilderness. He's been testing them throughout. So this journey is a test, am I right? And it is not an easy journey as well. So God says it has his own pains, as in the epistle of Peter says. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. My dear friends, though we have these trials and though we have to go through pain, and we are called to have faith, our genuine faith is rewarded and it has a value. God says it is much worthy and valuable than gold, and it is imperishable. How do we really practice this genuine faith? Because when the real trouble hits and when we get pushed against the wall, then this is the place that we really need to have this genuine faith. It's very easy to say. Let's look at the disciples in the Gospel of Mark. It says disciples were on the boat around 4 o'clock in the morning, and Jesus was walking on water towards them. Seeing Jesus, disciples get really terrified, and they think that it's a ghost. At once Jesus says, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. So Jesus calls us to take courage and not to be scared. Jesus asks us to take courage when the trouble times come, and to face it and live intentionally and knowing that God is at work, that God is in control. In Romans chapter 8 verse 31 it says, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? This is the promise, my dear friends. Aren't we to live in this promise? Finally, I would like to share that we are called to bring glory unto God in everything that we do. And we need to be faithful, and we need to have faith in him that he is in control, and that we are called to have genuine faith in him. So let's give everything that we have, no matter whether we are doing a job, whether we are at home doing cooking maybe, or whether we are studying, let's bring glory unto God with whatever that we do. we bring everything that we have. Just like in Colossians chapter 3, 23 says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men. Let's bring glory unto Him and let's have faith, genuine faith in Him. God bless you.
The Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, through whom all things were made, for us men and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day He rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and seated on the right hand of the Father, and He shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeded from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
During these intercession prayers, your response is, Lord, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for keeping us, our family and friends safe. We pray for those who are unwell with COVID-19, especially remembering those who are vulnerable due to underlying health conditions. We also pray for the ones who have lost their loved ones due to the sickness, who are lonely, scared and grieving. God be their healer and comforter. God, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. We thank you for all medical workers in Sri Lanka and all over the world who are displaying your love to humankind by putting the welfare of others before their own, by staying away from their family and loved ones, working around the clock through challenging conditions and working to heal and care for the sick. Be their guide, strength, wisdom and hope. God, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all those who are in armed services, police and other service personnel, along with everyone who are working in essential services. We thank everyone of them for their commitment and hard work to keep us safe and providing us with essential services and needs. We ask for your protection and strength on them and their families. We pray for President, the Prime Minister and all government officials. Grant them wisdom and guide them to do what is right for the country and its citizens. We also pray very specially for everyone who has lost their jobs, including daily wage earners who are finding it difficult to provide even the basic needs to their families. Help them to have hope and see your light even through these darkest of times. God, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, we pray for your church. Help the church to be a tower of strength for everyone during these troubled times. We pray very specially for our shepherds, Father Krishanta, Father Sirisara, Father Suresh, and their families. Grant them good health and your protection and wisdom to lead our congregation through these challenging times. God, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer.
Thy name, glory, reign so.
The peace of God which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.